Hey guys, welcome to 12 Tone. Today we're going to talk about 12 tone matrices, and if you stick around till the end, we'll have some tips on turning a row into an actual composition. Like a lot of serialism, this gets a little mathy, but don't worry, it doesn't really go beyond basic arithmetic. On that note, let's talk about notation. Up to now, we've been using standard note names with letters and accidentals, but those names are derived from tonal systems. We use seven letters because our scales have seven notes, and accidentals signify deviations from those scales. But 12-tone music is atonal, every note is equal, so when we get deep into it, those names stop being useful. Instead, we just use the numbers 0 to 11, signifying how many half steps above C the note is, so 0 is C, 1 is C-sharp or D-flat, 2 is D, and so on. Once you get to 12, you're back at C, so we reset to 0 and continue up again. This system lets us easily visualize intervals, which is more important here than whether a note is sharp or flat. This is just for composition, though. When you're transcribing a piece to be played, you should switch back to regular notation. That's way easier to read. With that in mind, let's talk about the matrix. This is a useful tool for visualizing the structures available to you, and it works like this. You start with a 12x12 grid. In the top line, you write your prime row starting on 0. Then going down the first column, you write your inversion. A handy trick to find this is to take each number in your prime row and subtract it from 12. So this 4 inverts to an 8, this 3 becomes a 9, and so on. Then, for each of the remaining squares, you add the number at the top of the column to the one at the beginning of the line. So this 4 plus this 8 would be 12 or 0, this 3 plus 8 is 11, this 4 plus 9 is 13 or 1, and so on. This takes a little time, but once you're done, it should look something like this. So what's the point? Well, if you read across each of the lines, you have every possible transposition of your prime row. If you read down the columns, you have every inversion. Reading a line backwards gives you your retrogrades, and reading columns from bottom to top gives you the retrograde inversions. This grid shows you all 48 possible transformations of your starting row, making it a useful reference for quickly determining your available options. And that's a 12-tone matrix. I promise we're done with math for now. Some of you have already asked what the next step is. To quote one viewer, many 12-tone guides just say, "Here are the row forms, now get out and make some spooky music." But how do you do that? How do you take a row and make music? Well, this is a hard question to answer because a lot of the fun of serialism is figuring out clever ways to exploit the systems, and if I could just tell you those ways, they wouldn't be all that clever, would they? But there are definitely some tricks to keep in mind. For instance, the contour of the melody still matters. Some of that is, of course, decided by your row, but not all of it. For instance, this and this are both D to E, but they sound very different. You can control the shape of your melody a lot just by choosing whether to ascend or descend. Range also matters, and where you put a line changes how the listener hears it. But a lot of the artistry comes from playing multiple interconnected statements of the row simultaneously. This is a form of counterpoint, and a lot of the tricks for making counterpoint work also apply here. For instance, speeding up one voice when the other slows down and switching back and forth which one is the lead. You can also bring voices in and out to create different textures or have multiple voices playing in sync to make interesting harmonies. Personally, I like to try to clearly separate the voices. This can be done by keeping them in different octaves or just giving them to different instruments. I just don't want it to be ambiguous which statement of the row any given note belongs to. I feel like it weakens the structure of the row, bringing it closer to free atonality, which isn't really the point. But that's just me. Many great composers have been more than willing to overlap their voices freely. You can also split one statement of the row between multiple voices or instruments. There's a lot of interesting games you can play if you don't need to state the entire row in a single voice. You can have one voice play a repeating shape while the other fills in the notes for various transformations. Or if your row has chords built in, you can have one voice play those while the other plays melodies with the remaining notes. On the other end, there's things like integral serialism that seek to impose even more structure, but that's a topic for later. For now, that's 12-tone matrices. Try the exercises, join our mailing list for scans of all our episodes. If there's any topics you want us to cover, or if you have your own advice for writing 12-tone pieces, let us know in the comments, and keep on rockin'.